Vinyl Esquire.
Just ready, Jason, man.
Yep,
stay in there.
Hey, Auntie.
Hi, babe.
How you doing?
That's
fine. Better, where Dre and Jinx at?
They in the back.
You're now listening to the legendary Vinyl Esquire.
Vinyl Esquire.
I keep going, give me a beat, Jinx, give me a beat. They be like, wait, hold up, hold up.
World of
how to survive the South Central.
Vinyl Esquire.
13, no debating. Beats I cut, keep the whoopers vibrating.
Yo, Jinx, man, we gotta find somebody that's down for hers, man. All these girls sipping, man. Who you think fit the category?
You can't play with my
Vinyl Esquire.
Don't try to play me out. Don't try to play me out.
Vinyl Esquire. Culture, truth, music. At Vinyl Esquire, www.vinylesquire.com.
Vinyl Esquire.
I got a job with the mob making cheese, doing some pickups, deliveries, and transport the keys.
You're now listening to the legendary Vinyl Esquire. Hello, world. I want to welcome you to Vinyl Esquire, the podcast that delivers culture, truth, music. Would you join me, please, in welcoming DJ Rick?
Hello, world. I want to welcome you to Vinyl Esquire, and my name is DJ Rick. And Vinyl Esquire is the DJ podcast that uplifts the DJ culture and honors our legends. And without further ado, I have the privilege on the line to interview the West Coast legend, the pioneer, the DJ, musician, artist, incredible producer. I would like to introduce and welcome to Vinyl Esquire, the legendary Sir Jinx.
Yo, what's going on, brother? Cheers.
Cheers.
What's going on? Glad to be on your show, man. Yeah. Spreading this good love.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Jinx. And how are you doing?
Oh, man, I'm doing great, man. I can't complain, man. I'm blessed. I'm a blessed person to be on this earth, still be alive. You know, back in the day, you know, we thought, you know, the life expectancy for a black man was 30 years old. You know, now I'm 50, so it's been a good ride. And still riding.
Well, you're 50. You don't look a day over 21, my man.
Thanks.
Well, Jinx, again, I want to thank you for allowing me to interview you for Vinyl Esquire. This is the DJ podcast that uplifts the DJ culture and honors our legends, and you are a legendary West Coast pioneer. So, with that being said, Jinx, I'm going to go ahead and get right to it. I want to get right to the beginning. Can you tell me who or what made you want to be a DJ?
Well, it goes way back, like, when my mom's, we used to travel, like, we used to travel and go camping, and my grandfather and my grandma, my uncles, they was like in motorcycle clubs and stuff like that. So sometimes my grandfather would take me, and I would see how people would react to music. So the music was usually like inside of a van or inside of a camper or something like that. So somebody would have to, you know, keep on going back and forth with it. The eight tracks and the reel to reel, they was having a reel to reel back then, and know how to keep it going. So I just saw how the music influenced people. Then plus, you know, my grandmother, my mom, and my uncles, they would have house parties and stuff like that. So I'm sure everybody remember when they was younger, well, around our age, all the parents would come over. It wasn't no such thing as a babysitter back in the day.
Right.
They just bring all the kids and stuff us in all one room, and we have to, you know, find a place to sleep. But I found a way to get out of that room, and that was to keep the music going. And they would trust me because I knew the songs. I knew what they liked. I knew how they responded to it. So I think that was probably around five, six years old around that time.
Wow, okay.
Because I remember the songs I was playing at the time. And if you, you know, go back to, you know, Darling, Darling Lady by the OJs, you know, that had to be 76, 78, somewhere around in there.
Right, yeah.
And Good Times with the Jackson 5, that probably was 75. So, and then, you know, Roy Ayers, that was 72. So to even know those songs, that's what made me. It wasn't DJing. It was actually just keeping the music on, you know. That's what I thought. Then the word DJ was connected to a disc jockey on the radio. but they you wasn't being called a DJ. Like, you know, you could just keep the music on. And my auntie used to do fashion shows and stuff like that. And I used to keep the music on. That keep the music going. Don't let the music stop. So, and very early, I love music and I love the sound of it. And, you know, everybody else in the family was, you know, into sports or into something. And that's what I was into. I was into the music.
Got you. So you're originally from Compton, California. Is that correct?
Nah, I'm from Los Angeles.
Los Angeles.
South Central California.
Got you. So you being originally from South Central Los Angeles, you were obviously a part of that early West Coast hip-hop scene. What year do you think that you would say you actually started DJing or being a real DJ?
Well, I think when I was a kid, I was a real DJ.
Okay. What I'm getting at is, when did you get turntables and decide to give yourself a DJ name and publicly DJ?
Man, that's probably... I was 13, 14, maybe around in there. Because my uncle was into music. So two turntables, that came later. So, you know, back in the day, cats had a component set with an A-track, with a cassette, reel-to-reel, and a turntable. And then you just balance the knob in between the two, and then you can hear both of them. So the two turntables came a little bit later. But I would say about 12, 13, around there. When I started manipulating the music, like making it play longer, you know, on the sweet part of the breaks,
right,
and pause mixing and stuff, because the pause mixing kind of came first, you know, we kind of record that kind of way.
Absolutely.
But DJing in front of people, I was probably 15.
So what year would you say this was, roughly?
85.
Got you. What was your first DJ name?
Master T.
Got you. Nice. So, okay. So it's 1985 and you're DJ Master T, correct?
Right.
Okay. So around this time, now you said that you started playing, you know, music in the late 70s, just as a kid at home, keeping the music going for your family. So obviously the 80s, East Coast hip hop hits the West Coast, right? So obviously this early 80s West Coast hip hop scene starts to brew and starts to grow. What do you remember from that early 80s time that made you want to transition to become an actual, so I don't want to say actual DJ, but, becoming, you know, who you were at that time and picking up those turntables in 85. What was that early 80s inspiration for you?
Being good at it. I thought I was good at it. Yeah, I think DJing is a sport at some point. And with me in the beginning, you know, I would see, you know, Grandmaster Flash, and I would see, you know, the different people, you know, manipulating the music. Because it wasn't really like the party scene. It was more or less a technique kind of instrument kind of thing. And being, you know, out in the West Coast, I was dealing with breakdancing. I was dealing with graffitiing. You know, I was dealing with rapping. I was dealing with it all, you know, all the elements pretty much. So it just depended on how I felt that day. One day I'm a graffiti artist. One day I'm a rapper. Next day I'm a DJ. It depends on, you know, when you're at school, you can't be a DJ. You know, now you got to have a little radio. I guess you can be a DJ keeping the music going, but then you start rapping in the circles and stuff like that. So the beginning, like, it was like, you know, Egyptian Lover and L.A. Dream Team and, you know.
Right.
And the Wrecking Crew and stuff like that. But it was more like techno music. Like, it was coming out of that disco era or whatever. And that's when I started, like, really wanting to. Well, it wasn't like nothing I wanted to do. It was like something I had to do. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
okay, yes.
I wasn't competing with nobody. I just wanted to be the best at it. I never thought I could be better than DJ Yella, you know, back in the day. You know, I never competed with Dre or nothing like that. You know, he was like, oh, everybody had their own technique. Like, Dre had his. Dre was real, real, real clean with the mix. Dre can do maybe 2-3 hours and not mess up or flange or beat or nothing.
Right.
Some of those kind of techniques he's good at. But then, you know, you get to triple threatening, you get to transforming, you get to, you know, doing, you know, different techniques. We all kind of mastered our own technique. So whenever, you know, people get on, you get on the turntable, you would master it. You would do that. You wouldn't do everybody's stuff. You wouldn't do all that back in the day. So when I did it, being involved with the hip hop, I just had older people around me that I just wanted to be better. I just wanted to be better than I could be. But I didn't ever want to compete with them, because I always thought that was just unforeseeable. Like,
absolutely. So in 85, you would say that you started to actually, you know, be a DJ publicly, you know, on the turntables. When did you become Sir Jinx?
I think it was more like in the eighth grade, somewhere around in there, because, you know, we got signed to a record deal when I was 15 to CBS, Epic Records. So
right.
When I had already had the name, but my Sir Jinx was my graffiti name.
Got you. Okay.
Well, actually, it wasn't Sir Jinx. It was just Jinx.
Okay. Got it.
I used to strike Jinx. That's what my striking name was.
Very nice. And you know what's interesting, Jinx, is, you know, I don't know if this is fortunate or unfortunate, but I think a lot of people put you in this gangster rap box, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I've always felt like you were all just real B-boys, really from the culture of hip-hop, not just gangster rappers. You know what I mean? So when you talk to me about you did graffiti and DJed and rhymed and all of that and graffiti, it just makes so much more sense. So with that being said, when did you start, you know, rhyming? Were you always rhyming and doing everything from the beginning?
Well, back when, you know, back in them days, the MCs, the DJ would come up and kind of do the third verse. So you had to be well-rounded back in the day. You had to know the steps. You had to know the routine. And then you had to also have a verse, you know. So
gotcha.
I always had a verse when we were doing, I think, the CIA stuff as well as Stereo Crew stuff. And then, like I said, when I'm at school, you know, I used to just sit there and write and get in trouble for writing and just putting words together, because Cube was really, really good at it. Like, he was really good at it. Like, his vernacular was big. Like, he had... For his age, you know, he knew how to match the words together. So
right.
Me and KD would go off on our own and try to compete with him. Like, right, you know, every time we come home, everybody had their notebook with their new little rhyme. And, you know, we just go back and forth and challenge each other. So Cube was the one that, you know, really challenged us to step our game up when it comes to rapping.
Got you. So
that's what gave me the cadence to deal with different type of rappers.
Absolutely.
Like, you know,
absolutely.
Some producers do real good with certain rappers, but, you know, I think I did well with Coogee Rap, did well with Exhibit, you know, did well with Corrupt, you know, and
absolutely.
Stuff like that. So I can make music for anybody. But the rappings, you know, that was back then with you know, I released a record on my own. I've done features on other people's projects, you know.
Right.
But
so,
main thing was just being a producer. Like, I can do it all.
Right. So I don't want to jump too far ahead. We're going to get to all of that. I want to back up just a little bit, because I want to paint the full picture of how incredible, an incredibly rounded artist, producer that you really are. So you mentioned it before. Let's talk about the Stereo Crew. Because to me, when people talk about Sir Jinx and your history, even Cube in the West Coast, they start you and Cube with CIA. And
right.
I believe that it started in about 1986 with a group called Stereo Crew. You had a record called She's a Skag, which was produced
right.
by Dre and Lonzo, I believe. So why don't you talk to me about the Stereo Crew and this particular record? How did that come about?
Well, we had four members of the Stereo Crew, and the Stereo Crew was myself, KD, Kid Disaster, Ice Cube, and a dude named Master B. His name was Barry. And Barry was Cube's sister's boyfriend at the time. Mm. But he had a car. So he had the car, but he was a lot older than us. So when we, not a lot, but back, you know, back in them days, 2 years, 3 years is a lot.
When, yeah, absolutely.
You know, if you're 15, 16, and he's 19, you know, or something
right.
like that.
Right.
Then that's a big split, you know, as far apart for back then. So when we start dealing with Dre, and Dre was coming around, and, you know, I was telling him, you know, I got a little group, you know, because me and Dre had a relationship before that, because Dre know how to draw as well. So he can draw real good. So back in the day, he used to come over with his portfolio of him drawing and all the stuff that he draw, like people faces. And, you know, I remember he drew a picture of Roger Troutman, the Great Mind album cover. Mm. And I was like, man, so Dre used to come over and, like, you know, flash on me with the drawings, and I'll, you know, show him my drawings. So then he started getting older, and he didn't come around as much. So when he started coming around, well, when he used to come around, I'd be eager to talk to him. Like, you know, Dre was just that kind of person. I was like, yo, I got this group. And I gave him a tape, and he was like, you know, he was interested. I wouldn't say that he liked it, but I would say he was interested.
Okay.
He was like, okay. He was like, why don't y'all come to the studio? You know, like everybody's beginning of their career, come to the studio.
Right.
And then Cube was there, and Barry was there. And Barry wasn't there because Barry had to work. Mm. So KD was there. So we started working on material and working on stuff. And then Clientele had left the wrecking crew. So Barry left us, not left, but he went to the wrecking crew. So his name was Shakespeare, I think that was the name. So
right,
he left our group and went over to the wrecking crew. And then from doing that, we started doing shows with the wrecking crew and opening up. And Dre didn't particularly like the Stereo Crew name. He didn't like the name.
Right.
So he changed it. He's like, yo, we came one day. We were working on a lot of music. I mean, we back in the day, rappers didn't make albums back in the day. You know what I'm saying? They just made very long 12-inch.
Right.
But
absolutely.
We started doing what the wrecking crew was doing. And that just said, oh, we wrote a song today. Oh, we wrote a different song. Oh, we got this song. So Dre was really impressed on how many songs we could come up with. Well, we'd knock out like 2 songs in one day. And that was a lot back in the day. You know, everybody got a computer. You can do it real fast. But to have the DMX and the equipment that we had back in the day, you have to, you know, have a 4-track machine, a 12-track or whatever. And Dre didn't particularly like the Stereo Crew. So he came one day and was like, yo, y'all should change it to CIA. And it was supposed to be Criminals in Action. So now at this point, the energy was changing in music.
Right. Okay.
The energy was changing from the techno kind of music. It was slowing down, and it was starting. LA was starting to get our own identity, because we had a little identity when it come to, you know, Ice-T and a lot of rappers that was out at the time. And we started getting our own identity, because we used to travel with NWA, with the wrecking crew, and we used to see how the girls would respond to them when they do kind of sexual gestures on the stage, or they might say one word and change that word to a curse word. So we took other people's songs, like Pee Wee Herman, it was the VD Sermon. Then we took My Adidas, changed it to My Rubber, and so on.
Gotcha.
So we was just cussing our face off. So this is the beginning of cursing, like, because we just get on stage and da 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 da, then the bitch suck my dick and I don't need to, you know, it's kind of like a real raunchy Roxanne, like that kind of world. And so that's where the Criminal came from, on CIA. But when we wanted to switch back and we got to, you know, do the BREs, or we do the, you know, the whatever it was, the music conferences with Lonzo and stuff, then we would change it to Caught in Action, because that wouldn't have been good back in the day. So that's how the CIA came to be. So that was like the first acronym, period, before, you know, everybody started using acronyms for KFC, you know what I'm saying? Like, I look at it like that, like all the stuff that people turn into acronyms. Well, of course, CIA was an acronym at first, but not really in the rap industry.
Right, absolutely. So you would say that CIA derived from the Stereo Crew,
And around the time when Dre put this record together, She's a Skag with you guys, he was in the record crew, and they were also on CBS, and they were putting out records. And then he changes the name, and you guys morph into CIA. And this is all pre-NWA, right? Obviously.
Right. Way before.
Wow. Okay. So that's incredible. So you ended up releasing your debut record with CIA in 1987. Called My Posse, and this was an extended 12-inch, right? Like you were saying,
it was like an EP, kind of like.
Right. It was on Crew Cut Records, which was Lonzo's label. Is that correct?
Right.
Okay. So you had My Posse, Just for the Cash, and Illegal.
Right.
On this particular record. How did this change from the She's a Skag single as a Stereo Crew to now this EP in 87 with CIA? How did this change the climate for you?
When we changed this to CIA, it started being more street. So even if you listen to read the titles off, Illegal, Just for the Cash, My Posse, that's more in going, that's like the beginning of gangster music right there. But we were still kind of like a Naughty by Nature. We was like a Naughty by Nature kind of group, kind of like a Tribe Called Quest kind of group when we with the Stereo Crew. But when the music started being a little bit more raunchy, but those wasn't raunchy songs, but they was definitely in the direction of where it all started being more our identity, like the West Coast started talking about what we talk about. And in the beginning, West Coast was talking about rap. We were talking about stories like New York guys with, you know, the Toyas and the Lottie Dotties and them stories.
Right.
But those stories are just random stories. Even go back to the Superman, you know, those are stories of that can happen anywhere. So we started more identifying, being on Crenshaw, you know, my fresh feelers kicked the door shut. You know, we got out of the Adidas. We started having our own identity, started wanting to be our own with that. And it was working for us. We was doing a lot of shows to be how I look at artists today. And they don't really, I can't say they don't do a lot of shows, but it's like the people just don't come out. Like back in the day, it was no internet. So you put the skate ring to open up and the little banquet halls to open up, it'd be packed to the ceiling. And people were just very green when it come to hearing rappers. And that's when we started changing. We started making music to do shows with. And She's a Skag was kind of like a takeoff on, like, Roxanne Shanté. It was like not on her, but, the song Roxanne.
Right.
It was kind of like that kind of thing. We were kind of following behind them. And, you know, you had the Beastie Boys came. So we was kind of like the rambunctious crew. You know, we getting in stuff and you know, we didn't drink or anything. So, we'll mention it in the thing. So that's why a lot of people say, you know, the vibe on the CIA was kind of like Beastie Boy. But we was just learning ourselves and learning what the world would want to hear, because there was a lot of rappers that was out that didn't try to, you know, merge the gap with sounding a little East Coast. And then we got more accepted by sounding East Coast than we would trying to sound like we was from the West Coast, because the West Coast music was fast.
Right, right.
You know,
right.
It wasn't even really invented.
Yeah.
Like that.
Absolutely.
So we kind of took on that, you know, and then Public Enemy was out at the time. And, you know, we just was picking up little pieces. And, that's how that happened with the CIA. And how then at the CIA time, that's when Eric came into the picture. So Eric came in the picture while we was traveling. Doing the Wrecking Crew, I think, was kind of falling apart a little bit, and then Dre did the Cabbage Patch, and that was when Cube started becoming a writer. So Cube wrote that song.
Right.
So back then, that was unheard of for rappers to write for somebody. But when Dre went on the road by himself, I think he was with Yella, with Arabian, me, Cube. And, you know, I at that point, I was still breakdancing, so I had my little spot, like, you know, the dudes that was dancing behind EPMD or, you know, Scoop and Scrap. I was like that guy.
Wow.
I would dance. I would be the dancer of the performance. So that was my kind of job.
Nice.
I wasn't DJing. Dre was DJing and Yella was DJing. So by at that point, then everything started changing. And then Eric wanted to have a record company. And when Eric wanted to have a record company, Crew Cut went down the drain.
Right, right. And I wanted to lead into that because, of course, I know you were there from the beginning of this. And Dr. Dre,
right.
Dr. Dre is your cousin.
Right.
And Cube was your friend, right? He lived around
right.
you. You introduced Dre and Cube together, right?
Right.
So at this time, and I wanted to know, like, what was this transitional period from World Class to NWA, Stereo Crew to CIA to NWA? So what happened that made Cube, or did CIA just dismantle and then Cube joined NWA and you came along? How did that transition happen?
Well, when we was all in high school, and like I said, L.A. was getting their identity. So while L.A. was doing their thing, you start hearing, you know, little tapes floating around the street. So people started doing their own tapes, and it was like underground tapes because they wasn't the kind of music that you wouldn't get a record deal for. So then you start hearing, like, the Mixmaster Spades and the Toddy T's, and, you know, the Mataram, and you start hearing stuff like that. About people talking about their area rather than talking about a random subject. So when Cube started writing, he started writing more about our neighborhood, like people, gangsters in our neighborhood, and what goes on in crime and nighttime and gangbanging. That wasn't, nobody didn't mention none of that. So that was our story. You know, we wasn't, you know, sitting the fella day to day. We wasn't that. We wasn't, you know, what was going on at the time. It was a little bit more closer to Just Ice. Like, Just Ice was real, real raunchy and real. We loved Just Ice. You know,
right,
we thought
right.
Just Ice was just, you know, listening to Just Ice was like sneaking listening to, you know, Rudy Ray Moore, you know, Red Fox back in the day.
Absolutely.
So when all that changed is when Eric, Q started writing more about the street, and that wasn't our image. That wasn't CIA's image to go that far. So when Cube was writing for Dre, then Cube started writing songs. So then Eric was in here. I said Eric came in the picture. So then Eric was like, I'm gonna give me a label. So Eric ended up getting these guys, and they were supposed to do Boys in the Hood. I'm sure you saw the movie.
Right,
and,
absolutely.
And they ultimately didn't do it. And then Eric ended up driving around with it in his Jeep. He had a Suzuki. And he would drive around, and then he ended up learning it. And from that point on, if I'm not mistaken, Boys in the Hood does not have Easy's name in it because it was wrote, Cube wrote it. And then he extended it to Dre because it was a little bit more raunchier, or a little bit, I wouldn't say raunchy because we was already raunchy, but it was more gangster oriented.
Right,
and
right.
Our stuff. We was like players, you know. Like,
yeah.
We was trying to be, you know, little playboys, little gigolos, you know. But that, the Boys in the Hood started talking about six poles and girls and basket weaves. Because this is the stuff that we were seeing while we were doing those performances. Like, the people that would come to the performances, they would look like this. We would start seeing that, you know, the tight parachute pants and the zippers, Michael Jackson shit started fading out. Now you start seeing Pendletons and khakis and Chuck Taylors, and it started changing. The wardrobe started changing. And that's when Eric started rapping. And Eric fit the description of the guys that's in them songs. But when Cube didn't actually leave, Cube had went to school.
Okay.
And when he came back, he asked me and KD, was it cool if he went on to be an NWA? Because NWA wasn't a group like that. NWA was a compilation. It was niggas with attitudes. So everybody from CIA, one person, Ren was from a group called Chaos.
Mm.
Arabian Prince was from Bobby, Jimmy, and the Critters.
Right.
Dre was from the Wrecking Crew. So it was like everybody, like, kind of like a We Are the World kind of thing.
Yes.
And that ultimately starts selling. So when Eric started, they started wanting Eric to do shows. You know, Cube already had Dope Man. So Cube started doing more songs with Dre in that direction. So he actually came back and asked me and KD is it cool if we join the group? And we was like, hell yeah, because we felt like we were in the group. You know, we felt like we all were NWA at some point, but he was the person kind of representing us, like representing me and KD.
Gotcha.
So Q did the same thing that Dre did for us. And Dre, when we had got into it with Lonzo over the discrepancies or whatever, Dre was like, don't worry about it. You know, yo, you guys are dope. I'm going to make sure you guys get on. And that was the same thing that Q told me and KD. He was like, I'm not going nowhere. I'm just working on this. And we're going to get back to business when I get back from school. But when he came back from school, he went full NWA, but we were still around. If you look at all the Easy videos, you'll see KD right there. You'll see me right there. And, of course, Q was, you know, the person representing CIA at the time.
Absolutely. So when Q decided to leave NWA as a group and go solo,
right,
was it natural for you to go along with Cube because you were already in a group with Cube before NWA? Seeing that you and Dre are cousins, was it just easy for you to go with Cube when he went solo? Was there ever any conflict between you and Dre because you did that?
Nah, it was, I mean, Dre is the type of person that be like, man, you will be a fool if you don't chase your bread. Like, you know, because when, and I always laugh, I tell people this, I it wasn't like I left, I wasn't employed there. I wasn't employed with NWA.
Right.
I was just around. So I went to where Q had said prior. That was a plan already.
Gotcha.
So it wasn't like, you know, he reached into a bowl and put my hand out and put my name out. You know, I was always there. When he would work on stuff with Dre and work with, you know, work on the stuff with Eric, and I was there. So it was like, you know, so he'll run stuff past me. Like, so I was kind of like his Ed McMahon with, you know, Johnny Carson. Like, I wasn't really seen, but it was a lot of influence that while I was there. Because, you know, Cube would run stuff past me, like, oh, listen to this. I just wrote this. He'd wake up in the morning, you know, come down to my house. I had a studio. I had a makeshift studio. And he'd be like, let me try it out. Let me test it out. That's
right.
What he used to call it, like,
right,
test
right.
out the rap and see if, you know, he'd sit there and work on it and fix it. Now I'll probably get a big beat, you know, boom, boom, ah, boom, boom. And then I'd do the same thing with, you know, Recipes, Jam Master Jay with the doom. Do that, do that. So while I'm doing that, he'd be, you know, get his rhyme flow together. And then next thing you know, it'll be on, you know, an NWA track or something.
Gotcha.
So he wrote a lot of stuff. Or it'll be an Eazy-E rap. Who knows what the rap will turn into.
Right.
I'd be like, didn't you write that for What's Go? I mean, didn't you write that, cause, you know, a couple months ago? And he'd be like, yeah, that's that rap. But it'd be a little different. But he would always come down and KD would come down and he'll still fuck with us. It wasn't like to be in NWA, like he turned into New Edition. Like, it
right,
wasn't like
I got
that.
You. I got
They wasn't together. They wasn't friends like that. They didn't hang out together. None of that. Cube never hung out. I don't know. Cube ain't never hung out with Yella. You know what I'm saying?
Mm.
Like, the age difference was too far apart. And
right.
Eric used to take us places. And then, you know, it was Laylaw. Laylaw was there. But they was all the same ages. I was younger than Cube, so that even built a further bridge in between how I got down and how Cube got down and how Dre got down. You know, they were friends like in the music industry, but they wasn't like homies though.
Gotcha.
So it wasn't natural for me to go to New York. That was the plan. You know, it wasn't no beef. The world made the beef. The people made the beef on how it looked from the outside. But if you was in the inside, you know, you'd be like, oh, no, I wasn't even like that. The outside people that wasn't in the inner circle made up the beast and made up all that. Because, you know, I'm sure you heard Cube say, and I agreed as well. Like, when we do the America's Most Wanted, we're not going to mention nothing about it.
Right.
When you hear America's Most Wanted, you don't hear no beef. You don't even know they exist.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah. And I want to go ahead and I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off, but I want to get,
no, go ahead.
Yeah, I want to get into that right before we get into that. So you, because this is about you. It's not necessarily about NWA, Cube or Dre or any of them. So let's get to this. So you said that you were always a B-boy. You did graffiti, you rapped, you DJed, and you danced. So you were a DJ, but in the interim of all of this with Stereo Crew, CIA, you rapped, you danced, you did all of that. So then now, okay, how did you get into production? When did you decide to go ahead and take it a step further and start producing yourself?
When we start altering the beat for, like, you know, for me to have a beat for Q or whoever, like the guys in my neighborhood, it was a bunch of people in my neighborhood that dealt with hip hop. And to alter the music, when I said that in the beginning, is I learned how to alter the music. So altering the music ultimately made me figure out where the sweet part was in the beat. And then that sweet part, that's when pause mixing came. That was back before, like, actually DJing and triple threading and doing all that kind of stuff.
Right.
But at first, we would just pause mix it. So at that point, that is a form of being a producer. That's how thin the line is. Like, you DJ, because most producers either was a DJ or a dancer, you know, which I was both. So
right.
To get into music, it was just, we wanted the music to sound the way we wanted to sound and not the way we was getting it off the record. So we wanted a bass line, but we didn't want the keyboard. You know what I'm saying? We wanted the 808 in it, where the loop didn't have an 808 in it. We wanted a rolling 808 hi-hat in it. We wanted the clap. You know, we wanted the Linn drum snare. Mm-hmm. We wanted the, you know, we wanted different parts of it to reflect what we added to the music. So I started adding more stuff to those pause mixes. So I do a pause mix with a beat, and then I take another part of another beat and mix it in. This is before sampling. So it's like do-do-do, you know, and I'll play a whole thing, the whole down, the whole 5-minute track. Like, so this is your accuracy. So it wasn't no sampling like that. Well, I didn't have it to where you could sample like that. So then I start stacking the samples, and that was the beginning of me wanting to be a producer.
Incredible, incredible. So now I want to talk about your production. So what production equipment were you using at the time? Let's talk about America's Most Wanted. I understand that you, alongside the Bomb Squad, you helped co-produce that whole album. And some songs you produced on your own, but you were an intricate part of creating that classic. Talk to me a little bit about that particular classic and what were you using at the time to produce some of these records.
What happened was I was dealing with this one cat, and I knew this. He knew this one dude. His name is Calvin Anderson. Calvin Anderson is the beginning of a lot of people's career out here. And I was dealing with Dre. And Dre had the SP-12. And the only way we could work on music is if we go over to Lonzo house, you know. So we was always eager to go to Lonzo house. So Dre would take the drum machine and bring it home. It's kind of a funny story. And then, like, Dre would come home probably like 3-something in the morning or something and bring the drum machine. I get ready to go to school. I'll play with it, you know, or he'll bring it. I'll be up 5-something in the morning playing with the SP-1200. So then a knock at the door would be at the door. And then DJ Pooh and King T would come over at like 8 o'clock in the morning to pick the drum machine up so they could take it and work on it. And they'd bring it back. And then Dre would take it back to the studio. So it was like maybe 4 people working with that drum machine. So I couldn't take it. I can only deal with it as fast as I could. And I would need discs. You need a disc. And I didn't have none of that. So, the guy Calvin that was helping me, with my music and my career, I would say, he ended up buying me one, and they was expensive. They was like $2,000. Like, I just made Calvin maybe like a month prior. I was like, hey man, you get this for me, man. It'll change my life. It'll change your life. It'll change everybody. So he went and bought it for me. And most of those beats that I made on that drum machine, I was trying to get groups signed to Ruthless. Like, so I was doing stuff like doing beats, trying to place beats with JJ Fad and I think it was Gilmore Markey or something like that back in the day. And then hopefully to score one with Eric, you know what I'm saying? Like, or NWA or whatever. So that was that drum machine. Right? So when we went to New York, it wasn't like I made the beats there. I had brought I called it my bread box, because it looked like a bread box. Boy, because it was wood and the little thing came up, but it kept all my discs. Like, so I had a whole bunch of discs dealing with my man Calvin out of Long Beach. So this is when Long Beach started, you know, was at his infancy stage when it comes to doing music back in the day. So when I went to New York, I had already had the disc, but they didn't use SV-1200. They used like Akai stuff and keyboard kind of samplers.
Right.
So they had long samples. So they had to get an SV-1200 brought to the studios for me to rent it so I can play my beats.
Mm.
But to go back to the drum machine, my man Calvin, you know, he started feeling a certain kind of way, like, hey, man, you know, and this was before Maximum Hornet. He was like, you know, because people didn't really know how the drum machine worked. You know, they thought that the drum machine made the beats. They didn't know you had to make the beat. They thought you can just push a button
right.
Has all the stuff in it. So Calvin was like, you know, you got to leave it here. You know, if you want to work on it, you know, you can come on here. So Calvin got mad at me a little bit and made me leave it out there. So it'll be my homeboy Slice. That's the dude that originally brought me there. And I showed everybody how to work the drum machine because Calvin started making like a little makeshift studio. So it's funny, the dude Slice, you can look him up and the story will be accurate. And then so now a guy comes over and looks over at, you know, listening to Slice, you know, sample. I think he said he was sampling a Computer Love or something like that. And the dude was like, how did you do that? What are you doing? And da da da. So long story short, that dude turned out to be DJ Quick. Like, so then another dude came. He wanted to do it and work on some demos and do whatever with that drum machine. That dude turns out to be Warren G and Snoop Dogg. So my drum machine ended up doing the same thing Dre drum machine was doing. So I thought that was kind of dope. But
wow, that's that's incredible. That's incredible. Go ahead.
So later, when I end up hooking up with this one guy, this had to be the right time. So Calvin wouldn't let me take it. So then I end up calling myself running away and moving out. Moms was tripping on me. And I end up moving in with this guy. Well, I didn't move, man. I just stayed over there.
Right, right.
And a guy named Mike Conception. So me and Mike, Mike Conception was real deep into the music game. Like, he knew Michael Jackson, Teddy Riley. Like, he knew all the people. So I asked him, like, man, I could change the world. Same goddamn story. Change the world, man. I changed the world. Buy me this drum machine. So Calvin bought me one. So then I had it at his house. So then he would let me take it around and do whatever. So a lot of the beats from Calvin's and a lot of the beats I did with the Mike Conception's SV-1200 ended up being on a lot of the music that I did. That's why that year when I did all that music with Yo-Yo and we dropped 3 projects in 1 year, you know.
Right.
Or with 2 projects with the Death Certificate and the Kill at Will and also the Dale albums and the Coogee Rap albums. You know, I just had an abundance of beats when I went to New York. So I started playing my beats for Eric Sadler, you know. So I felt like my beats was dope. I wasn't mannish. I wasn't shy. I wasn't nothing like that. I really wanted to go. But I don't think Q brought me out there to work on the music. He brought me out there, I think, to be moral support, you know what I'm saying? Like, and kind of keep the studio in the direction that Dre had us working. Because that was the only person we ever worked with like that.
Gotcha.
So for him to leave Dre and go out there, you know, we didn't know what they had it in store for us because we didn't work on demos. I mean, every song we worked on ultimately became a real song.
Wow. That's incredible.
They didn't send no beats or nothing. We just came there and start picking up records and stand at that 510. We were standing there, but a few beats got developed in the studio. And then we went to the studio. But if I didn't have those 2 drum machines, I wouldn't have had no beats because if you look at it, if I was trying to get beats to JJ Fad and all the people that was on the roster of Ruthless, and then also I had my own groups and I had my own stuff. So I didn't just make those beats up. I had those beats for, you know, maybe a year or two before I even went to New York. So So I had a whole bunch of beats when I was out there.
So this is amazing on how we pull back the layers and really find the inside story of how these things really came about. Because America's Most Wanted is a classic album. And you can tell that there was that West Coast, kind of a driving force with the Bomb Squad sound, right? And clearly, obviously, that was you and Cube. So after that, you went on to produce Kill It Will, like you had mentioned, Boys in the Hood soundtrack, The Predator, and Lethal Injection, right? So talk to me just a little bit about on how it goes from you collaborating or being a part of America's Most Wanted with the Bomb Squad to you single-handedly producing the next, three albums.
Well, I didn't single-handedly do it. Well, Death Certificate was, I was kind of like, the Kobe and DJ Pooh was like the captain. You know, he was like the Shaq.
Got it.
So
okay.
when we did Kill at Will, those are mostly remixes. So when I was dealing with, of course, My Conception, and I was dealing with a lady named Karen Jones and Benny Medina at Warner Brothers. This is how the Coogee Rap stuff happened. So they start asking me, because the mood was changing with hip hop. The hip hop was becoming the bottom beat was changing from, the Atlantic Star kind of sound, that was out, the Deal and those kind of sounds was changing. So they had me doing a bunch of remixes. I did a few remixes on a guy named Trey Lou, and Trey Lou is George Clinton's son. Mm. So I started getting real cool with Benny Medina. And then they would just ask me to do just random little remixes, like just throw a little kick under it, do whatever with that. So when I did Kill at Will, it was mostly just remixes. I think it was only the Product and Jackin' for Beat was probably the two original songs on them. The rest of them was remixes. And a lot of people don't know that Jackin' for Beats was supposed to be a response to N.W.A. talking about Q, but nobody ever got it. That was the first strike when Cube started striking back at them. But what happened was when we did Jackin' for Beats, the original track on the front of it was, I think, Niggas for Life.
Right.
It was that Niggas for Life beat. And I think due to the fact that it was the original song, Easy denied us usage of the song. So if the original Jackin' for Beats was like, give me that beat, fool, it's a full-time Jack move. And it was supposed to be going at them. So if you listen to the end of it, that's why I go, stop, surprise, nigga. But nobody got it.
Right.
So that's why the No Vaseline was made, because that didn't really come off like that. But when we, we stood on that went platinum. And then DJ Pooh was like, around. He started being around a lot. And he was, because DJ Pooh was helping me when I was dealing with Calvin. And I had put out a record with Calvin with another artist. And I had put out a couple more records without Cube and without all that. So I was already in the studio by myself,
Okay.
So by the time I got to New York, that was the same thing, Then for me, knowing a process by dealing with Dre, there's a process of being in the studio. You do something a certain way, follow these certain rules, and it should work for you. So, but DJ Pooh had already, was producing Cool T and LL Cool J and stuff like that. So we kind of needed, a vet. So I would call him a veteran at the time. We was all young, but he was the one that kept the studio in line to where that's what I was doing in New York.
Gotcha.
Well, actually, I wasn't doing that. Hank Shockley was doing that for America's Most Wanted, but I was just kind of like, kind of steering the ship a little bit when it came to some of the opinions that, we were at odds with. Not arguing, but should we do this? Should we do that? Hey, let's do this. Good idea. Hey, let's do this. Damn, that's dope. We all kind of was putting everybody was putting their own parts on the car,
Right.
If you use that analogy, everybody has something to do.
Right.
But when we did Death Certificate, DJ Pooh and Bobcat was there to kind of be the captains of the team at the time.
And I know your little touch with the intros and the skits and, you know, all those types of things that that you added that sauce to it and that support. So Q wasn't there by himself, right? You had that full West Coast leverage there, you know, with the Bomb Squad. So, you know, incredible albums. These are all classics. And I just don't think that you get your proper due as a producer. And I say that because, you know, you have produced and helped co-produce and was a part of a lot of classic records. And aside from Cube, obviously, you know, you guys launched Yo-Yo and you produced her first two albums, right? Which became classics in their own right. And then you also went on to produce artists like Coogee Rap and Rage Against the Machine, CeCe Peniston, Gerald Levert, Too Short, Dale, right. Belle Biv DeVoe, Corrupt, Isaac Hayes, a lot of records would exhibit, just to name a few. I mean, did I miss anybody?
Nah. I mean, that's a good enough roster right there,
It really is. So, again, it's just incredible to me that you did.
So you Keith Washington, Tony Braxton, Soul to Soul. I can keep you out. Tone Loc, I can keep going.
See, here we go.
I'm just thinking of other people, you know, and Sounds of Blackness, Mint Condition, a whole bunch.
See, that to me, that's incredible. And all that production that you've done, from remixes to, you know, a project production and producing,
right,
all these classics, I just don't feel like, you know, you get named, mentioned as you should, which is why I wanted to bring all these things up so we can really paint the picture from you coming from a young B-boy from South Central Los Angeles. Yes, you're related to Dre. Yes, you were friends with Cube. And clearly, you know, that talent from the family and all of that, you know, comes full circle. But everything that you've done from that point up to this point, that is a lot in a tiny, small, you know, time frame that I don't think that you actually get acknowledged for enough. Okay?
Well, I look at it like this, and I'm probably going to say it a new way right now because I just thought about it.
Okay.
It's not about who starts the race. It's about who finishes it. So when through those times, producers wasn't popular. That wasn't the end thing. I mean, we rap it. We read the credits, but people didn't read the credits. They didn't. That wasn't what was in then. You know, they probably read the thanks to, like they read that part.
Sure.
But you remember on the back of the record, they used to say thanks to the people,
right?
And that would make you think like you knew all these people. We used to put people on there we didn't know sometimes. But this was back in the day,
right?
And,
right.
We weren't really cool with like that. We just say thank you for, you know, whatever you did. But what I contributed to the team is not to overshine what the purpose is, you know, because people say that I'm dope and I'm stuff like that, that's them saying it. I never wanted to be that I'm dope type of producer. I didn't want to get stuck, like you were saying. I didn't want to get stuck in the gangster world. I didn't want to get stuck in the R&B world. I'm just a producer. So if you stretch it out and look at my credits as a producer and rap, and look at my credits as, you know, working with, you know, R&B artists, and, you know, looking, you know, doing all kind of different kind of music that a lot of the people wouldn't even know that I was into.
Right.
You know, then it starts being a little bit diverse. It's like MMA. I didn't come in just to rope a dope. I didn't come in just to left hook. I came in to grappling. I came in to do a lot. Like I never wanted to study the tool. I always wanted to study the craft. So as I keep studying and doing more and more, it opens up more doors. It's like an onion. You keep pulling it back and pulling it back. It's more. It's getting more refined. It make it cry more. You know, when you start playing with it and for people to say that I don't get the just due that I've gotten, trust and believe, I got the trust due that I appreciate. Like, I came to do what I did. Just like I always use the analogy of Robert Ory. You know, Robert Ory might not be the most respected or known a basketball player to hit the court. He's not even in the front line of one of the greatest that played the game. But he also got 7 rings. So at some point, he made the team better. He made winning shots, game-winning shots. So,
absolutely.
I mean, you know, I've been in this game so long that I'm humbled to help people more than help myself. That's probably one of my problems. But, you know, but it's a good problem to deal with. It's a gift and a curse. But I never really wanted to be like a Quincy Jones or a Teddy Riley or a Marcus Miller, you know.
Gotcha.
I just wanted to be on good teams. I wanted to be on banging albums.
Right.
And most
right.
of the albums that I've done are all classics.
Absolutely. And that's why I brought that up. So I just wanted to salute you, you know, give you the acknowledgement of you being an incredible producer. Because, again, I mean, I don't know about duds or hits or, you know, in between, but I think majority of the things that you've touched have all been classics and hit records. You know what I mean? So,
well, I think I've been a part of a good understanding when it comes to producing a record. Because when we go into making records, it's not, I don't know how other people do it. I see how a few people do it. But most of the time, when me and Q, or you know, me and Exhibit, or G-Rap, or you know, whoever, even Dale, the album was already thought out before the concept and the theme of the record was, and we was matching songs to the theme. We wasn't making songs and then make an album title. We had the album title first, and it had to sound like that sound. So I had a good staff of people. And don't forget Rush that was with on Death Certificate, that part of the Boogeyman that was with DJ Pooh. You know, he was a part of it. Even King T threw his hat in the ring, and he did Nappy Dugout. So there's, you know, there's everybody was just, you know, a part of a good team. I was blessed to even be around them kind of people. Who would have known?
Absolutely. That's incredible. So with all of the people that you did produce and work with, is there anyone you did not get a chance to work with that you wanted to or still want to?
What, in rap music?
I mean, any artist. It could be rap. It could be anyone. Any particular artist that you may not have gotten a chance to work with that you wanted to?
Oh, man, it's a thousand people. I mean, you know, I feel like, you know, I sell weapons, so I just want to see people shoot them, you know. So
right.
Gotcha. Man, for me to be the first rap producer from the East Coast, I mean, from the West Coast, to produce entirely, not the entire record, because Trackmasters added something to Coogee Rap's record. But in the beginning of the Coogee Rap record, I was the first producer to produce an entire East Coast record. You know, well, you still had the L.A. Posse that worked with L.L.
Right.
But I did the majority of the records. So when I got to work with G-Rap, that G-Rap was one of the guys. Like, he didn't know I even knew him. I heard of him. But, you know, because Karen's like, hey, you want to work? You want to do some remixes with the Coogee Rap project? And I was like, hell yeah. Like, you know, hell yeah, he can rap. That dude can rap his ass off. You know, I already knew about the symphony. I already knew about, you know, the beef between them and KRS. I was the Source magazine to you know, my neighborhood. But, you know, I wanted to work with Jay-Z, of course. Jay-Z, I almost got a chance to work with Jay-Z, but that fell through.
Okay.
I always wanted to work with Sauce Money. I thought he was hella dope.
Right.
I always wanted to work with Lars Professor. I thought Lars Professor was dope. I wanted to work with Sadat X, but that did come true. I ended up working with Sadat X. I wanted to work with Chuck D. I ended up working with Chuck D. So I like the lyrics, man. So, you know, I tried to get in there and work with Scarface, but that didn't really pan out. But I always wanted to work with him.
That would have been dope.
Yeah, we tried. I was out there and went out there. It's a lot of people. It just depends on how I feel. Like, I feel differently. Like, you know, I could work with a E-40. I haven't worked with him.
So again, I just asked you that because you've worked with so many people that I'm sure that any of those other individuals that you still obviously can't work with, the projects would be incredible. So why don't you talk to me?
The crazy thing is, and then the people that I have worked with that it didn't get known. Like, I was working with Melly Mel, you know what I'm saying? I was working with Tragedy, you know, Intelligent Hoogum. I worked with him. I worked with Mark. Marquise from Two Live Crew, because, you know, he's from out here, but he was in Florida.
Right.
So
right.
It's like a whole bunch of people, like Candyman, you know, he got his start by living at my house, you know.
Right, right.
So he was on the cover of the NWA thing, so... It's just incredible, like all the people that I did work with. But you know how it goes. Some stuff just don't go. And some stuff, the moons line up perfect. It probably has nothing to do with the song itself. It's just the timing of the song makes it a hit.
Right.
Neat.
Absolutely. So why don't we talk a little bit about your solo albums? Because in the interim of you doing all this production and working with other artists and family, obviously, and your West Coast family, you put out some solo records. Just talk to me really quickly about your solo albums that you put out.
Well, the solo album came because I was getting a little tired, like you say, being pigeonholed, and I was people wouldn't be interested in my work because of the fame of the songs that of the artists that I work with, and they thought that, you know, I was just that kind of producer. So when I tried to do my music, it was just me venturing out and I can say sharpen my tools, you know, just doing music that I like, because most of the time when you submit beats to rappers, you got to make it innate and how they like it. You know what I'm saying? You're like, oh, I'm going to make this beat. I don't particularly have to like it, but I'm like, oh, this beat can go to that person. And then when they get on it, you know, they turn it into something that I really like.
Right, right. A hot song. And, absolutely.
Right, right. One of them was one beat that I thought was just a meager beat, and it surprises me every time. I can make 20 beats, and right before I'm getting ready to leave, I said, "Oh, let me put this ugly ass beat on there," and that be the one that gets sold.
Yeah.
You know, it'd be like, "Oh shit, who would have thought you liked this?" So one of them was like Dead Homies, like when I did Dead Homies. I think Dead Homies was on Kill That Will 2, matter of fact, if I'm not mistaken.
Right, right.
And that was a meager beat to me. That beat was kind of a relative of Who's the Mac to me. Like when I did Dead Homies, it was kind of the same concept. But when Q got on and he put those thoughts on it, man, I didn't see gangbangers cry, man.
Right.
Gangbangers walk off, you know, that walk off, like, you know, something in your eye, you know. That, I really got that response out of that song, and that's no fucking lie.
Yeah, and it had a video and everything. I mean, it was a dope record. I definitely
right.
get it. Yeah, absolutely.
But, that's about it right there.
So speaking of Cube, you know, you've worked with him, obviously, you know, his whole career, but you worked with him a little more recently with some of his more recent albums, as well as you were a part of the unreleased famous Dr. Dre Detox album, right? So
that went down here.
Yeah, so talk to me just a little bit about that. I mean, these are more recent projects, you working with Cube and Dre versus, you know, 20, 30 years ago when you were doing it with them. How did it feel, and was it very much different now versus then?
Working with Dre is pretty much the same thing. I mean, you come in thinking optimistic. I mean, you have to be optimistic. But you got to catch Dre on when he's in that kind of mood. Like, so I won't say that he'll shoot your shit down. It's just the wrong time. Like, so you can play a beat for Dre, and then he'll go back to it and be like, wait a minute. Like that, and then, you know, you still at the highest peak of working when you submit beats to Dre. So you're not just giving Dre a demo oriented type. Well, they are demos at some point, but you see what I'm saying, like unproduced and
Absolutely. Someone's
just working on this thought. You know, you kind of got to bring it to life. And with Dre, and then Dre, if Dre can add to it, or Dre can change it, then he really likes it, you know, because sometimes, you know, you just need that extra push. So when cats be like, oh, well, Dre didn't produce the track, I say that everybody produced the track for Dre, you know. So at some point, they are Dre's mind. You know, when I make beats for him, I make beats knowing that this is going in that category. This is going to be on these type of artists. So I just don't make beats and then just let them play and let them all play. It'd be distinctive what track that is going to make it over there.
Right.
And then with Cube was a little bit different, because Cube writes by himself. So sometimes he'd just get the beat and take it and come back. Well, he basically was like that all the time. But with him being more of a celebrity, you have less time with him. You know what I mean? Like, it's not a bunch of playing around and joking. And, you know, he's in there. He'll take care of his rap and he'll leave. So I was like one of the only producers that he would just leave me in charge of my own track. But some people, he'll like kind of oversee it and he'll tell you what he likes. Cube will really tell you what he likes. But if he liked the track, he won't say anything. He'll just be like, that bang. And he'll just take it from there. And you know, you do what you do with it. So
gotcha.
When he got a little more popular, it's just less time you could spend with him and make up concepts and stuff like that. Because when they was working on the West Side Connection record, you know, I would go and play him beats and stuff like that. And then I heard the... I think it was Keith David, I think that's his name, did a like a monologue thing for him. I was like, man, give me that, you know, because I'm good with the inserts. And people right. usually call me and want me to do the inserts.
Right,
so
the intros, the skits, and all that. Yeah.
Right, right. That kind of opened the door a little bit with us getting back in the studio. It felt the same. It almost felt like, you know, how Harden and what's his name? Like, they both was on OKC, but now they both on the same team again. You know, it's a little bit different, but maybe probably after three, four hours, you start seeing the old Cube, you know, you start hearing that the old Jinx and talking about old stories and stuff. But make it brief, because he got to go.
Right, right. Well, I mean, you guys are much older now than you were then. You were, you know, you were younger, you were kids. So, you know, it's just, I know that relationship is a little bit different, but it's just interesting, you know, to see the dynamic of then versus now. And
right.
But I just wanted to see, you know, what, you know, how you felt about that, because in the interim of all of that, you know, you kept really busy with producing and you even made some video. Well, you made a lot of video appearances with your artist and Cube, but you made video appearances. You've made TV appearances, DJing. You had a cameo in Poetic Justice, the film, and you were depicted in Straight Out of Compton. Obviously, do you like working in film and video equally as producing, or is it just a part of the whole package for Sir Jinx?
Well, it hasn't been that many. I'm more of a behind the scene kind of person.
Mm-hmm.
I like to see a project come together. I like the dirty work. I like to, you know, paint over the duct tape. You know, I like cleaning it up, making it look presentable. I like the technical part, because when I was in high school, and I was pretty much in everything. You know, like, that had to do with the arts. You know, I was in drama class. I was in stage crew. You know, I was, you know, in the art program. I was, you know, and then I wasn't in the band because I was in stage crew. And those were two classes that would happen after lunch, like six period kind of classes. But I was always in the band. I was always, you know, I was the dude at your high school. Whenever the teacher needed that VCR and the TV to come to the room, I was the one that was bringing it, because I had keys to the auditorium. Mm. So I always been, you know, stage crew, knowing, you know, the lights, the ellipsoils and the curtains and the walk thing. Well, you know, I was all over the place. So to be in the mute and the movies, it just kind of reminds me of that. So who knows what my future has, in store for me. With being more of a front man, but I'm really comfortable behind the camera and behind the board.
Got you. To switch gears a little bit, but it's relative. You have put out solo albums in the past, but more recently, over the years, you've put out some instrumental albums, right? So
right.
Talk to me a little bit about your instrumental projects.
Well, I do, dealing with my instrumental projects, you know, most producers that on the level that I'm on, we can make music out of anything. I could give me a bucket and a chain and a dog bark. I can make something out of it.
Right.
You know, and with dealing with my music, producing them in I have a studio, but some of the songs are produced in a big studio. We call it a big studio, not a real studio, but a bigger one. And I have the live instrumentation, the background, different people coming in, doing different things to the song. So the song ultimately becomes valuable because of how much money I put into it. You know, I started investing into the song. And then when you shop the song, the person got at least double me back on what I spent on the song. So a lot of the songs start being too expensive. People are like, I don't have that. And then pay me for the track and pay for the studio time. They'd be like, I don't have it. With my instrumental records, I started just kind of giving them away. Like, not giving them away, but giving people a reason to write more music, to write to. Because a lot of people always like, Jeez, give me a beat, you know?
Right.
You know, I need to write. I want to write to it. I need to, you know, get my writing up. And I hate rapping over somebody else's talking. You know, a lot of people say that. So for me to push those out and to give people just my young mind and the ideas, how far I go when it comes to making music, it's not just like I don't have a signature sound, you know, so I just like to be all over the place. One minute I'm sampling Frank Sinatra, and then another thing, you know, I'm sampling, I don't know, some Brazilian drums that you have to use a lifetime to try to find these samples. And people be like, yo, where did you get that sample from? I'll be like, yo, I gotta kill you right after I tell you. So you might not want to know where I got this from. You know, right, I might be dead on these records. You know, you don't know. And that was the fun thing about, you know, making beats is where, how did you come up with it? And you don't even hear the scene. You don't even know that it's the sample. You know, you know what I'm saying? So when I start putting out the instrumental records, I try to instill to the producers out there, you know, don't become a producer, you know, a producer that's just a hoe to the rappers. Because some rappers make producers produce music that don't get sold. But I was listening to records a long time ago, and every time, case in point, like Marvin Gaye. So I listened to Marvin Gaye, the best of Marvin Gaye, and then turn around a few years later, I find another best of Marvin Gaye. I find another one. But all these, all the songs are different. They're not different in sound, but the sequence of the songs are different.
Right.
Understood. So you know how you get used to a song coming on after the song go off, you get kind of used to it. So in my mind, I was like, I can do that with my beat. I can take my beats that some people haven't heard and reintroduce them. You know, they my kids. I look at my beats like my kids. I got to take care of them. I can't just leave them there. So I started making instrumental records. So some, and then take the hooks off of them and do some. So take all that off. And it, when new rappers hear them, they hear something different in it, entirely different.
Right.
Where one could have been a gangster song, now it's a thought-driven song. Or a song that was thought-driven can turn into a shake your ass girl song, depending on the rapper that hears the beat. I believe the beats can all have new identities. They can be, you know, refurbished and used again.
Absolutely. And was that always your approach with production from the beginning, was to not put yourself in a box and just do what was dope?
It depends on how I feel. That's why I didn't have really no signature. I tried to make a signature back in the day by using the same hi-hat. And I said that a long time ago, how I made my own hi-hat. And that's how you'll know that I did the track. Because I, you know, the Easter eggs, I used to get the Easter egg and get sand and then get a hammer and smash the sand until it's fine and then make a shaker out of it. Or take the sand and add a rock in it and it's you know, I had a box full of shit that I made. Like,
wow.
And those are the signature sounds that you can't buy. Like, if you have this sample, if I heard that sample on anybody's record, it'd be impossible for them to get it unless they came to the studio and got it off the, you know,
right.
off the rooms themselves. But most of them sounds were sounds that I made. Like, you know, to go back to the Marvin Gaye and Michael Jackson, and you can actually hear now that I think Don't Stop Till You Get Enough, that clink is a Coca-Cola bottle.
Mm-hmm.
So if listen to it now, you'd be like, oh, that is like a fucking Coca-Cola bottle. You know, you can definitely hear it. We was kids, you just thought it was like a Beltry or something. I don't know what kind of sound.
Right.
But when you listen to it now, even Marvin Gaye got something with a Coca-Cola bottle in it, you know.
Right.
For me to just to develop all those sounds and keep going and keep going and keep going, that's what I believe that you as good as your equipment back in the day. So I tried to make mine so diverse to where now everybody kind of use the same computer, use the same machine, use the same thing. Ultimately, the beats are going to sound exactly the same.
Yes, you're right. Right. So what are you using now in 2020 for your production?
I use Reason.
Okay.
I'm really stuck on Reason. I use Reason and Pro Tools.
Okay. Okay. Incredible.
I still use Pro Tools.
Got you. Well, it still sounds
amazing. Can't get around that.
Yeah, it sounds amazing. Are you still an active DJ?
Yeah. I actually DJ more than I produce records now.
Nice.
Because I have a club. I DJ a day party, and I have a company with my guy, DJ Space. And, you know, I'm a nobody in that world, you know, because it's not about DJing. Because we do weddings. We do, you know, we do DJ for junior high schools. And, you know, the Sir Jinx is not there. You know, I'm Tony when we do that. You know, we do all kind of stuff, retirement.
Wow.
For the police department, for car dealerships and stuff like that. So yeah, I still DJ crazy.
Wow, that's incredible. So what projects are you working on now? What new projects do you have coming out in 2020 and in the near future?
Well, I'm working with a few different people. Right now, I'm working with Jail Felony and helping him get his catalogs and getting his stuff together. You know, with me being the age that I'm at now, I'm more of an administrative kind of person. So to jump in bed with somebody and create a brand new rapper, I'm not really too interested in that. I just like when I come to the table and show a cat how to get their money and show them how to do it right, how to set this up, set that up. I'm working with another dude named Big Ant, my guy out of San Diego. It's funny, they both out of San Diego. But it's a few people that I'm just working with to help them not only get their music heard, but also to make sure their business is correct. Because if you take care of your business in the beginning and it don't turn out to be crazy hectic later, people
right.
get to forgetting what they say. They don't know how to do the splits, you know, those kind of things that I, you know, try to tell the producers that I work with. You know, I come from a long line of producers that are under me, you know, that I've been working with, you know, like the Day Ones and, you know, my homeboy Theod. Not that they're under me, but I came out before them. So I kind of like was like the overseer when it came. Then I turned into DJ Pooh, I should say, you know, and my homeboy Choir Boy, you know, a lot of the guys, my little young guy, Mike and Keys, that, you know, did a lot of the Nipsey stuff. And a lot of the producers, you know, they definitely need that administrative help that artists get. But producers kind of get left to the wayside when it comes to dealing with the business.
Right,
know?
Right, absolutely.
So I've been more or less on the business side, connecting people with lawyers, connecting people with the right people, connecting people with distribution, getting their music played, getting their video with more streams and stuff like that. I've been more on the internet side with dealing with, you know, the monetizing stuff and you know, just getting that so people can own their own business. You own your own business, you can pay yourself whatever you want.
Absolutely. Now, I think paying forward that information and that knowledge from everything that you've been through and from the beginning. I mean, when we started this interview, we're talking about late 70s, early 80s, and we're talking about 1985, right? And now here
right.
we are, 2020, and you're still active, you're still DJing, you're still producing, working with artists and giving them that information. That's incredible, because that's what the younger generation needs, is elders like yourself passing that information and teaching. So, you know, so they won't have to go through what you may have went through when you were younger in the business, right?
Well, I wouldn't necessarily say they're not going to go through it, but at least they have an option.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
when we was back in the day, there was no option.
Right.
You didn't have a decision. It was no. It was either yes or no. It wasn't like, well, can we work this out? And I don't want to be signed for 7 years. And what do I owe you? What is my split? What do I owe? How many points do we get? You know, we didn't know none of that. They was just saying, hey, sign right here. We'll give you this money.
Right.
And always just getting a whole bunch of money can put you in a whole lot of debt. So
absolutely.
I'm happy the way the industry, some guys be going hard on the younger guys. And I feel just like how, like, Kareem feels. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, like, yo, we wasn't getting money like that. Like, they getting real money. I don't know who's pressing it up, but obviously they're giving it to these kids that are on the internet. I don't even know if these kids got bank accounts. They just hold all their money in their pocket. Who knows?
Right.
But I've never held $100,000 in my hand up to a picture, you know.
Right.
So
right, right.
Something has to be different.
Absolutely, absolutely. So Jason,
I applaud them for that. I like that the newer people can dress up hip hop and it didn't fall down. You know what I'm saying?
Like, right, right.
Like other genres of music, you know. Like, it was funny. I was watching the show and they were talking about Seattle. And they were talking about, what was the Seattle music called at one time? Grunge or something like that?
Right, right.
Like grunge, wasn't that their title for their situation?
Mm-hmm.
But you don't hear nobody saying that. Like, you still hear rap music. And the kids, they getting their money and they putting a new face on rap. And the rap ain't going nowhere. It's probably probably the highest selling behind country music. I don't think nothing's bigger than rap but country. I ain't fucking with country. Country, there'd be people that career is over with and you ain't never even heard of them. And they went triple, quadruple, platinum and all that. So I'd be like, yeah, you don't want to mess around with country. You don't want country people not to like you.
Right,
that'd
right.
be bad.
You're over, right? Absolutely.
Right. So, they'll shut you down.
Right. So, Jinx, before we get out of here, can you give me one crazy story from Sir Jinx's history? Just give me one story, something that people may not know that was groundbreaking that happened in your career.
Man, I don't know. You would have to ask me. I don't know. Everything is crazy. I would have to think of what...
You know, just something memorable that people may not know, you know, something that may have happened, you know, with you, you know, Cubed, whatever. But, you know, something from your perspective, something that may have happened that was incredible in your lifetime. If not, don't worry about it. It's fine. It's okay. It's okay.
Some of these names have to be changed to protect the innocent. So I don't know. I'm not really good at story. And then what's his name came in and Blase split
right,
up.
Right,
right. Yeah,
that's okay.
This is. I don't know if anybody knows this, but we was doing the Apollo, right? And this is the first time we did Apollo. So when we got the news that the Apollo had sold out in like an hour or 2 hours or something like that, so they had to add another date. I think it was on a Saturday, and they added another date for Sunday. So we do the show. The show is banging. And so the crowd is, I don't know if you've been to Apollo, but sometimes the crowd, you've been to Apollo, right?
Absolutely.
Right. It depends on the people. They can get really rude. They can start yelling shit. So the Apollo is not that big, right? So on TV, it looks like it's real big, but it's like a high school auditorium to me. It's like real small. So if somebody yell from the balcony, you can hear them clear as fuck. You know what I'm saying? So we do the show. Show went off without a hitch. The little boy came out. Yo, Q, man, kick some shit for the Apollo. Everybody went crazy. Then because my DJ equipment was up top, so I see, you know, because where the lights are. Sometimes when you perform and you can't see because the light shines directly in your face, you can't see the fucking crowd.
Right.
So at this point, I can see above the crowd because my lights are behind me and I can see. So I start seeing something. Boom. I see something else. Boom. Go across stage. See something else. Boom. Go across stage. I'm seeing it again. Boom. I see something fall on the stage. Doop, doop, doop. Fall on the ground. I'm like, these motherfuckers is throwing shit at us, right? So they keep throwing it. Boom, you see it. Boom, boom, they rolling it up, throwing it. Boom, guess what? They throwing money on stage.
Wow, okay.
So this is one of the routines out of the Apollo, and they say it only happened, I think, twice before with Slick Rick and maybe with Public Enemy, or maybe with Public Enemy, maybe Slick Rick and Big Daddy Kane. Who knows? But this is a rare tradition that happens at the Apollo, and this is 90. So this is not today's time when niggas is throwing money.
Right,
this is
right.
a long time ago. So somebody had opened the side door, because whenever you look at the Apollo, you look right there to the side, you see an exit door. Somebody opened that door. It was sold out. The back of the Apollo was filled up. Everybody ran into the Apollo. So when they ran into the Apollo, they couldn't check for seats and tickets. They just shut the door and say, start the show. So you couldn't even see the road in the Apollo. This is how many people ran in that motherfucker, right?
Wow, incredible.
So I remember Jam Master Jay, rest in peace. Jam Master Jay went, put out his pocket and threw all his money on stage. And Q just rapping with the money just falling and falling. And then we had two homies. We used to call them the homies. And they used to stand on stage like gang members, right?
Right.
Man, I swear, everybody from T-Bone, JD, Shorty, I think it was one of my homeboys, just two security guards that stand in the front. Everybody, when the curtain closed, everybody was scrounging around on that floor. I think the lowest somebody got was maybe $60, and then to the most was maybe $200.
Wow.
Off the money that they threw on the stage, right?
Wow, so, that's incredible.
So look, so we living on cloud nine, like we rock New York, we rock this bitch, we high five and we going back to the thing. So then the next day we do the show, and this is the funny part. So the next day we doing the show, everything is good, we all lackadaisical, yawning, we're gonna do it again, rub our nails on our shirt, we're gonna do it again. So they start to smoke, because I think Cube had an electric chair on stage.
Okay.
And they fog the whole back of the curtains up and then open it up. And then you see Cube sitting backward in the electric chair.
Right.
So right at that point, when the car opened, then we start playing Payback. Boom, boom, boom. And then the motherfucking, the electric chair started turning in the circle. And everybody start going crazy, crazy. So now I have a DAT player. So any DJ and people know that work with DAT players know they're a piece of shit.
Right.
And they will fuck you up. And they'll do shit like the hold button will be on, because this is what happened. The hold button was on. So now the thing is spinning and the smoke is dying. And I'm sitting there like, oh, shit. Something happened where I went to push the thing, what happened, the music never started. The curtains opened up and the thing started turning, the music didn't start. So then they had to close the curtains again, right? No, they didn't close the curtains. The smoke started, fading out a little
right.
bit.
Right, so now you can see everything.
Right, right. So people, you start hearing, oh, he's not in the room, sorry. So a dude in the audience say, y'all ain't gonna make it to the airport. Then everybody started laughing, right? So I got a hot mic phone. So I'm thinking, now I'm Kevin Hart. I can do whatever I wanna do. So I said, shut up. That's why those lips look like two busted hot links, right? So it went quiet. And then they really started booing.
Oh,
that's when they closed the curtain. So Coogi Rap was there because he was on the show with us. Coogi Rap and K-Solo. So G-Rap, because I already had worked with G-Rap. So G-Rap was like, hey, that would have been funny if you said two busted Franks. They don't know what a hot link is.
Damn.
So he said that would have came off if you say your lips was like two busted Franks. Then they would have got it. He said they didn't know what a hot link was. So then after that, everybody was saying the Sandman had to come get the DJ. I was the only, that's the case. Like, they wouldn't let me lay that down forever.
Wow.
That was funny. But the throwing the money was something that's of the norm now. That was not the norm. I thought the motherfuckers was throwing shit.
Wow, that's incredible. That's what I meant by when I asked you of one of those incredible stories, because unless you were there, you don't know anything about that. Like, it never happened, right? That's an incredible,
right.
Incredible story.
And it was a bunch of shit going on, man. I swear the Apollo ain't no joke. They usually block it off at both sides, and them dudes ain't to be played with. I mean, I don't know. You might not want to just, you know, walk down the street. You know, you smell like bait.
Mm, yeah.
You can act tough if you want to, but at the end of the day, you're going to meet other tough people as well.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely. And an incredible story. Yeah. So that's what you did on the road with Q, was you DJed for him, right?
Right.
Okay. Gotcha. Incredible, incredible story, Jinx. Well, listen, I want to thank you, you know, for allowing me to interview you because,
thanks, man.
Man, you are a legendary DJ and producer. You're an iconic, individual from the West Coast. You know, what you've done for West Coast hip hop, the DJ culture is unparalleled. And I just wanted to thank you for allowing me to interview you for Vinyl Esquire. So, Jinx.
Well, man, thanks for having me on and, caring about it. Like I said, it's been a long ride. It's been, I enjoyed it. Been some ups, there's been some downs, you know, but without the downs, you don't have ups. You just live a blank life.
Absolutely. So, Sir Jinx, how can our listeners continue to follow you?
Or they can catch me on my Instagram, DJ Sir Jinx. Or they can go to my YouTube channel. I'm going to start putting up more product. You know, just keep their ears open and their mouth closed, and they'll figure it out, you know, on what I'm doing. I got two albums in online right now called The West Wing. Sir Jinx Presents The West Wing. And I have another album called Hood War Order. And it's just some dope music that I work with Noble and Corrupt and Roscoe, King T, MCA, Gangster from the Conrads, Chill from CMW. I don't know if I said King T. I mean, I got a whole bunch of music that I think people will enjoy. It's that good old school West Coast. Well, when I say old school, I mean the original sound. Like,
absolutely.
How it sound, not old school. I always say that. Like, I'll be like, oh, that ain't out on the old school field, but they brand new.
Right,
you know,
right.
Sometimes
right.
I just say old school like that. But they some good music. Every time somebody hear it, I sent it over to you. You can tell me how you feel about them. And they some real good music. I want to love for people to check it out. It go up every year. I didn't had it out for a few years, and it has never stopped selling. Or somebody's playing it somewhere.
Well, absolutely. And what you sent me was incredible. I loved the instrumental albums. I love the new projects. And I say you keep making those classics. And, it's not going to stop.
I got one right now. I mean, thanks for reminding me. I'm releasing two right now. One is called Jinxtrumentals 2. I have Jinxtrumentals 1. And the one I'm releasing, I think on the 24th of July, 2020, is Imperial. And Imperial album is an instrumental album that I did. But all the beats are from the 90s. I had found a bunch of my DAT tapes and got a DAT player.
Oh, nice.
And went through maybe like 100-some DATs and found beats of that time.
Wow.
So it's like a real strong SP-1200 presence in the beat. So it's probably from 90 to 95 on this Imperial instrumental record. So that should be out on the 24th of July. I still got to turn it in. I haven't turned it in yet, but I think I got a release date on the 24th of July. So, man, yeah, I will hope y'all go check it out and check out, you know, the other beats that are out there. You know, feel free to look at YouTube. They're all on YouTube. You can play them, you know, do whatever, you know.
Nice,
It's all up to y'all. I just want to stay in the loop and be humble and continue learning this crazy, crazy thing called music.
Absolutely.
I learn something every time I touch a keyboard, or I just open my mind and deal with the, you know, with the science of it, you know.
Absolutely.
It never stops. You never stop learning.
Absolutely. Well, Sir Jinx, you know, obviously they can find you on social media. Go to YouTube and find all the new music, the instrumental albums, your solo albums, and, of course, your catalog of production from the 80s to now is unparalleled, and it's all out there. So I want to thank you, Sir Jinx, for coming on Vinyl.
Thank you, brother.
For coming on Vinyl Esquire. Vinyl Esquire is the DJ podcast that uplifts the DJ culture and honors our legends. And you are a West Coast legend, a pioneering DJ, and an incredible producer from the West Coast. So I want to thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah.
I want to thank you for coming on Vinyl Esquire. And you're now listening to the incredible Sir Jinx.
Let's go.
Hello, world. I want to welcome you to Vinyl Esquire. The podcast that delivers culture, truth, music.
East Street looking motherfucker.
Jericho,
you talking that bullshit on your way out the door, nigga.
Well, there goes the talent, Dre.
Shut the fuck up, baby.
I'm saying, how the fuck we supposed to make a record label and hit records and we ain't got no talent? I mean, you said hold up my side of the deal. You said put some money up. So it's time for you to deliver.
Why don't you do this shit, E? Nah, for real, get in there on the mic. You ain't got shit to lose. It's your money. You paying for it.
No, I can't. I'm not a rapper. There's your rapper.
I'm in a group already, man. Jinx and them will trip on me if I do anything.
Look, I understand that you want to keep throwing your life away with Jinx in the backyard boogie band or whatever, but I'm the paracord of this shit. So whenever y'all figure out what y'all want to do, just let me know.
Well, I was at this party, feeling kind of hearty, so I went to the bar, ordered Coke and Bacardi. Yes, I was chilling like an ordinary dude, smelling real good, could see the attitude of then I saw a freak that I think I'd admire. I strolled on over and sat down beside her, said I'm Ice Cube from the Stereo Crew. She looked at her friend and they both said, who? Ice Cube to rock the joint, could see the MC, but that's beside the point. And don't turn your back, baby, just give me a chance. I only walked over to you to ask for a dance. To dance, yes, baby, it's you I select. To get you on the floor is the main object, but you a stuck up flick. I tried to hit, coming in dead last at a beauty pageant.
She's a stag.